Hello everybody and welcome to ECigTV. How's everybody doing tonight? I got Dino, the master of disaster, here tonight with me. Apologize about that, I was getting a little echo. And we're working on a new format. I have my green screen on tonight. Watch this. I can turn that on. Make me look like bright from the side. Not so bright. I look better in the dark. And then wait, let me see if I can show you. Super dark. Not welcome. Ain't so good. I got green screen lighting on here. So at any rate, tonight, welcome. We're Dino's up here. Ooh. Oh no, wait.
Very sophisticated stuff we got going on here.
I tickle him. I can't see how I'm doing it. Look, he's laughing, see? Yeah, so we got the green screen set up tonight. My wife's over here doing technical, so if we better or worse, we'll probably be better than we ever were, but if we're a little bit worse, don't worry about it. We'll get it worked out. She does a pretty good job overall.
Thanks, honey. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. All right, so tonight we're going to talk about, we're going to bring Kevin in around 8:30 or so, and in the meantime, we're going to talk about
stainless cable. Steel cables.
Stainless steel cable. So, rebuildable out of use, obviously. I'm going to give something away a little later. I can't figure out what yet, but it ought to be something pretty cool. And what do you want to start with, Dino?
Well, let's see here. I got a couple of different kinds of cable. Two different sizes. I actually don't remember the sizes, but I wanted to show you the difference between there. Some of these cables come with some kind of a nylon thread in between. Uh-huh. And what you got to do to prep these things, I boil them. Now my dogs want to start. I boil these to clean them out, and then I'll torch them. But first, what I do is I try to get rid of this thread.
And where is that? Is that actually in the...
Yeah, I think it's what they use to actually form this material. You know what? Hold on a second. I'll be right back. I'm sorry.
He unplugged this thing. Turn his power off. I think he's going to go beat his dog. But at any rate, I was in vape stock last week, man. What a blast that was. Your sound's off.
How's that better?
Oh, yeah, that's perfect.
Yeah, sorry about that. Anyway, so this stuff has got to be prepped. And the first, a lot of people, what they've been doing is trying to burn out this nylon string. And I figured out a way to get it out without torching it, so I know it's out completely. And pretty much what I do is I take, this stuff is pretty strong material. You need some good cutters for it. I actually use these Nipex cutters. These are what they call parrot nose. And I don't know if you could see, let's see here. You see they got like a real, like a rounded tip on it. So it'll catch the cable and it'll cut. I mean, you could see it's real clean cut, so it doesn't fray.
Yeah.
But to get this thread out, what I do is I kind of twist it opposite of the way they wind it. And if you look, you see how it's starting to open? I don't know, can you see it on the camera?
Yeah.
All right. And pretty much what's happened is I'm unraveling it. And in the process, I start to pull out this string that's down the center, little by little. And right. I keep going with it. Now I got all this section. There's no more string left in it. And then all I do now is I just roll it in the proper direction. Oh, I just blew it. I just screwed it all up. I may have to get another piece for this. I went too far. Yeah, I'll do it on this one.
You lost it, right? You went all the way.
Yeah, I lost it. So anyway, here, it's coming apart, all right? And then when I want to put it back together, I'll just twist it back in the same direction. And it actually just kind of goes right back to the way it was. And you pretty much got, you know, you got to clip the end a little bit, but, you know, it's pretty easy to unravel and then just kind of just put it right back together again, just to get rid of that.
Let me ask you this, because it's kind of hard to tell. And I honestly, I've never seen this stuff. What's the diameter of that?
Well, the bigger stuff, I have different sizes. I have some
that's... The bigger
one
was the one you had the first time, or was that the same size?
No, this is smaller diameter. This is actually...
So that's the way it looks. I just want to clarify.
Yeah, this is about 2.5 millimeter. The first one that I destroyed, this right here, was 3 millimeter. And depending on the size of the wick hole is the size, you know, that I'll use. I'll show you how the stuff cuts with this cutter. I mean, you can literally just pop it. And it cuts really, really clean.
I'll tell you what, it's crazy. I've never seen a pair of them cutters before. And I was
years. I tried using a regular pair of, like, you know, nipping pliers. And what happens is when you try to cut it, it flattens out the cable. And it winds up looking like that.
Yeah, yeah. Now, is that a cable cutting tool? Is that like a cable?
Yeah, this is actually, these are wire rope shears. Is what they are. They're kind of expensive. I mean, they're $40 to buy these. But rather than fight destroying all this mesh or taping it up and using a Dremel and getting steel dust all over, these are probably the cleanest cutting stuff I've found so far.
Right. Well, it looks like they're set up to do like crimping and all that.
No, I think they got some kind of crimping tool underneath it also. You know, I would imagine for some kind of a coax cable or something like that. Mm-hmm, but, mm-hmm. You know, it's well worth the money if you're going to use this stuff. Because right now, this cable, I mean, I've used silica, regular stainless steel mesh, and, you know, all these. This stuff wicks better than anything I've used yet. I mean, it literally wicks vertically. It's that good.
Right.
So. And what I do is, like, this Addy right here, this is, I think this Addy's from Russia. And you'll see the wick hole. And what I'll do is, I'll take this, I'm not going to set this whole thing up, but what I'll do is, I'll set it into the wick hole and then try to get a gauge of where it needs to be cut. And that, like, right there, I got to probably take off another 1/4 inch. So what I'll do is... I might as well cut it.
Wow, that looks like a nice little Addy, brother.
It's a beautiful Addy. It's actually titanium. It's got a threaded top cap. And if you see, I don't really dig the donkey on it. Actually, is that better? Yeah, that's better. It's got a little donkey on it. But, I mean, it works well. It works really well. So now what I'll... See what I mean with these dogs? They're going to drive me crazy tonight.
Listen, we can't hear them, so don't sweat it. Just
oh, good. I'm glad. All right, so now what I'll do is I got the wick cut to size. I want it to be around the top of the... Just shy of the top of the post, which is about where it is right now. Now I got to do is I got to take another piece of... take a piece of mesh. And... Pretty much what I'll do is figure out what the height from the Addy deck to the top of the positive post. And I'll cut a strip. So I'm going to cut a strip like that. And you can see it's about the same height. Is that coming through okay?
Yep.
Okay. Now what I do is I'll torch it. So, let's see here.
So you're not torching that cable at all?
I'm going to torch it. Yes, I am.
Oh, okay.
I tried setting this stuff up without torching it, and it was next to impossible. I had nothing but trouble. I was getting hot spots left and right. It was shorting out. So I guess the torching oxidizes it enough where it I got to get another tool. Hang on a second.
All right, we'll wait here. Why torching are we waiting?
Oxidizes
enough.
Well,
I'm going to talk a little bit about a couple items I've tried this week. No, he's back.
All right. So what I want to do is here. Let's see here. I'm using a bigger torch to get this done a little faster. I'm going to do it on this camera. And you can see it heats up pretty quick. I just want to get it till it's glowing. Make sure you do the whole thing. Now, you don't have to use this torch, obviously. I'm using this just to expedite things a little bit.
Now, you're dipping that in water because we don't have that up on the screen.
No, I'm just torching it. I'm not dipping it in anything.
Okay.
And now I'm going to take that little piece of mesh that I had, and I'm going to do the same thing to the mesh. Actually, I don't need this big torch anymore. And I'll just torch the mesh just to get it.
Wow, you're a twin torch dude, man.
Yeah, buddy, I got it all here.
It's pretty
the right tools for the job. All right. Now, what you got to do with this stuff, when the wire lays against this cable, it creates gaps. So you got to create a smooth surface for the resistance wire to lay on. So what I'll do is I'll just take a little piece of mesh and I'll roll it over the top of the cable. Let's see here. And you want that on the top section, pretty much where the coil is going to be wrapped. All right. So now that I got that wrapped on there, I'll drop it in here again. And you'll see now the only part that's sticking out is the cable that's wrapped with the 400 mesh. Is that camera good enough? You can see it okay? You got me, Drew?
Yep, looks good.
Okay. And before I use it, I'm going to torch it one more time just to be on the safe side. And I'm really only going to be torching the top section. So here, there's my dogs again. I'm just going to torch that. Now, after I torch it, then I'll make the flame like this and run it over. And what that does is creates a little bit of soot on the mesh. And if you can see it, let's see here. It's kind of blackish.
Right.
So now you got a real, it's pretty much charred up now. And then pretty much you take it, you put it in the attic. And then you wrap your coil, whether you're using a regular round cantal wire or a ribbon wire, and that's it. That's how you prep this stuff. Let's see if we can get a good. And that's it. Now, as far as maintaining it, I mean, I've had some of these wicks that I've been using for months. And I literally, if I want to put a new coil on it, I'll take this out as gunked up as it is. And I'll just torch it till it glows again, and I'll reuse it. And, I mean, this is one that's finished. Let's see if you can see that, if there's a good picture there. And I'm telling you, this stuff wicks so well.
Now, that mesh that you put on there, that's basically just so you're getting a better contact?
Yeah, it's essentially what you're doing is you're creating a smooth surface for the wire to sit on.
Okay, you said that.
Because it's the cable is kind of irregular. You know, it's got, because it's twisted wire, it's not, you know, it's got bumps in it. So what you don't want is you don't want to have any of that wire that's not making contact, because that's going to give you that harsh, you know, burnt taste, you know?
Yeah.
What are you doing?
No, I was tickling your chin a little bit. It looked like it was itching. This new screen, I like it, man. It's fun.
Yeah, I can see you're going to be playing with it for a while. Yeah. But I highly recommend this stuff. This is all I'm using now is this stainless cable, because it wicks so well. I mean, sometimes if it overwicks, sometimes, you know, I find that I have to really get it in that wick hole to kind of restrict it almost. But it works tremendous. I mean.
So, yeah, I talked to you, I guess it was a little while ago. I forget, the last time I saw you, I was asking you about that. And you didn't give me a clear answer. So it looks like it's a thumbs up for ordering some of that stuff, huh?
Oh, definitely. No question about it. It's not expensive. I mean, you could buy it for less than $1 a foot. And, I mean, it lasts so long. I mean, I got so much of it now, I probably never have to buy it again. But... It even tastes cleaner to me. You know, I don't know why, maybe it's just my imagination, but it just works so damn well. And the stuff that I'm using, there's a couple of different types. First of all, I'm using 316 stainless steel. It's 7x19 wrap, which is 7 wraps of 19 wraps, if that makes sense. So what they do is they take 19 small cables, they wrap them in one long rope, and then they take 7 of those 19 wraps and they wrap one rope with that. So it's called 7x19 is the stuff. They also make a 7x7, which I heard works okay, but the 7x19 is just, it works perfectly. So I've been buying that. And it's all 316 stainless. And you can get the stuff, I have some of it as small as 1/16 of an inch, up to 3/32, or even bigger if you want. But the 7x19 is the stuff that I'm really really liking a lot.
So the diameter, you're using the difference in diameter, you're using the biggest that you can use with that particular mod?
This is like a 2.5 millimeter wick hole. So this is, I think, just over 2 millimeters. You're not going to find the perfect size all the time. But essentially what you want to do is you want to be able to make sure it fits in there. I mean, even if it fits in there tight, it's not going to hurt anything. A lot of times when you're doing a stainless steel mesh wick, I actually roll those wicks a smaller diameter than the wick hole itself so that I get some of the juice flowing on the outside of the wick as well. In this case, it's not even an issue. If you can fit it in the wick hole, that's how good it'll work.
Right.
What I will do is I'll make this mesh wrap. Sometimes I'll add a little more so that I can actually take the cable and let's see here if I can do it. I'm actually going to try to get that mesh where it's sitting in there real snug in the wick hole. So now it's really clogging up the wick hole.
Right.
Typically, setting up with a regular 400 mesh, you don't want to clog up the wick hole. You want to leave some space around it. With this, clogging up the wick hole sometimes is better because this stuff will sometimes over wick. Mm-hmm. So if you clog up the wick hole a little bit, it'll slow down the wicking a little bit, which you'll actually, you got to experiment with a little bit, but it's once you figure it out, I mean, it's the best there is. You cannot beat it.
Okay, so we'll leave a window of opportunity for the people in our ECigTV audience to ask any questions, but we're going to be bringing Kevin in just because he's a barrel of laughs. And what, hon?
He's ready.
Bring him in. But, you know, one of the things for me, you know, I've been basically ignoring these things, and you know, you know this, so it might sound redundant to you, but you know, I could never get, you know, I made the atomizer a couple of years ago, and used that. I basically used it until I mastered making a good coil, and I used that one good coil, and I burned it up, and I never made another one, you know, except for testing. So, full screen him. So, Kevin, so, you know, I sort of got away from it, but I was down in Florida, and I was hanging out with Laurel. Vape Stop was a blast, by the way, but I was down there hanging with Laurel and her sister, won a Nobel from Vapor Craze, 310 Vapors, or... I think I'm saying that, 301 or 310 Vapors.
Noble one from 310 Vapors, yeah.
Yeah, I met these guys, man, let me tell you something. They look like, probably what a lot of people say about me, like I look like a real creep, but I am. But them guys, they were super cool. So they happened to be walking up. Laurel's sister says, you know, I don't really need this thing. I want something, you know, I want to plug, you know, turn the key and drive. I don't want something with all this shit. And I said, you know, whatever it's worth, I'll give you the money for it and I'll try it out. So when she happened to be walking up, when they were walking up, they took it, they set it up in their room. Let me tell you something, man. This thing works amazing. It's like a 3-second drag, you know, it's like a cigarette. And the flavor on it is unbelievable. I put this liquid in that I bought earlier at the show and tried it. And it was really good. And then I took it back to the room and tried it, and I didn't like it. So, you know, that happens to me all the time with liquids. I'll take a hit off it. It'll be, wow, that's great. And then I'll take it and put it on something else or use it on a different device or a cartomizer. And I don't like it. So at any rate, they set it up with that. I'm telling you what, man, I was vaping it for the rest of the trip. It was unbelievable. So when I got back, I had Dino up and I said, look, man, I got to start messing around with these things again. But so Kevin has had a similar experience. Hey, Kev, how you doing? Welcome.
And boy, does that seem like a pain in the ass. He's got torches. He's got tools. I mean, I got to say that I've just kind of given up on the rebuildables. I really have. In fact, I'm going in the opposite direction. I just bought something today that looks so simple, and I can't wait to get it. But I went back to my amp tank. It vapes great. Drew's right. When you first get it together, the vape is fantastic. I haven't had anything better. But that only lasts, in my experience, that vape you get will last about 2 or 3 days. Then you got to start cleaning it. Then you got to rebuild. You know, it's all this crap that goes on with it that I just don't want to deal with. I'm a lazy vapor. I mean, I am. I want something that's easy. Amp tank, you just fill it up. This thing I got today, you just fill up these big cardos that come with it and screw it on. You're done. I mean, that's what I am, and that's the direction I'm going in. I love the rebuildables, but it's too much work. It's too much of a pain in the ass. It really is.
And I listen, I have to tell you, I sort of agree with you, but you got to try this one I got from this dude, man. I'm telling you. And listen, every time I see Dino or any of these guys that are into them, like Effie or any of them, I try theirs. It's like, bang. And I'm like, God, it's got to be the liquid they're using. Like, Dino vapes this cream de menthe stuff. Dude, it's like taking a shower in your throat when you vape it. It's great. I mean, it's like you take a couple hits off and you're completely satisfied instantly. So I'm always thinking, well, you know, this guy sets it up and it's a big pain in the ass. But, dude, I'll tell you what. If I could get that all the time, relatively easy, like as long as I'm not making one of them Maddies, you know, once a day. If I could get one to last, like he just said, he gets it wound up, he uses it for a little bit of time, he retorches it. If it's just a matter of me retorching it, I could live with that. And I understand. The other thing is that I've been saying all along, like I can't understand what these people, they're nuts. Like why would you want to have all these cables and torches and meshes and wires? And, you know, when I first started, I did that with regular, you know, atomizers, cartomizers. I remember when cartomizers were new, you know, so, and I'm not bragging, I'm not trying to sound like, you know, like an old timer big shot, but I had that kind of enthusiasm then to just do whatever. Like I could sit there for 4 hours and, you know, like a mad scientist. But now I'm more like you're saying that, you know, listen, I just want to, you know, like Carl's sister said, you know, I just want to turn the key and drive. I want to fill up the atomizer or cartomizer or whatever. But the reality of it is, bro, is everything aside from a couple of the CE4s that I use, they all take some tinkering to some extent or another. Like even these, the carto tanks. Like I went through it with them. I baked them for months and months with no issues. And then all of a sudden, it's like the bottom fell out. Same thing with bottom coil cartomizers. The EVOD, the Pro Tank style, all those. Like, when I first got them, I filled them up. I said, wow, this is great. It's easy peasy, ba ba ba. Next thing you know, I get up in the morning, there's a pile of juice on my dining room table, and I can't fix the thing. I can't figure out what it's doing. I shot a device out, one of my opuses. It leaked into it, or shorted it out, or did something, or it had a metal shaving in there, or something, burnt one of my devices out. And listen, they were nowhere near the hit that I'm getting off of this rebuildable. So, listen, I'm not arguing with you. I'm just, talk about both sides.
I've always been a guy that likes to tinker with everything. I mean, I don't think there's a device that I have that I haven't modified in one way or another. And so, with me, it's almost like it's enjoyable that I'm doing it. Kevin, on the other hand, I kind of figured that it was going to last only a little while. I was hoping, you know, he'd like it more, being that, you know, it was working so well in the beginning. But, I mean, it's like anything else. You got to put in the time. You got to want to do it. And, you know, I got to tell you something else. I mean, I'm using an HH357, and I'm dripping it. And, I mean, I have carto tanks all over the place. I could use them. But it's the quality, I think, that really pushes me.
Well, I think Drew brought up something interesting, and he's right. In the beginning, when I first started vaping years ago, and there wasn't really much, but like, for instance, when I got my first kit, I got my Blue 6 kit, all right? It didn't work. It worked like shit. And I would sit there and tinker with those carts forever. I would put the blue foam mod, and I was trying the Fluval mod, and every mod you could think of, any type of filler you could think to put
tea bags, yeah.
Yeah, the tea bags, right. They get it to work better. I was putting in there, and I would tinker with it all the time till I got it the way I wanted it. I think if you start, when you start vaping, if you jump on the rebuildables fairly quickly, I think most vapers have that in them to want to take something and just make it better. And that I think that's why rebuildables do so well. But after you've been vaping a long time, I think some people fall into the category where I am, where they just want something that just they fill up and go. They're done with tinkering. They're done with playing around. And listen, I had that LavaGen at Vape Bash. When I first started it, it was the best thing ever. It was fantastic. I've never had anything vape better than that LavaGen. When it first got put together, it was great. And I really thought, it's so good, this is going to make me motivated to want to have to tinker with this thing when I have to. But it just didn't, you know? I got too frustrated, and I've been vaping too long, and I've just fallen into this, I just want to fill something and go. I don't have the tinkering thing in me anymore that I did when I first started, and I think a lot of vapers do when they first start.
Well, and Kev, I got to tell you, you're a lot like me. That the day that I hit it, if I'm not in a tinkering mood, that can spoil it for 6 months, because all I got to do is get aggravated one time, and I got too much stuff. You know, I got all that stuff laying around that I can just, you know, do something else.
Yep.
But I'll tell you what, man, that the one I got, it's in the house now. The one I got set up from these guys, Kev, it's fill and go. I filled that thing probably 40 times. I can take a 3-second hit off it and blow a cloud right out.
If you get it set up right the first time, and all you got to do is be conscious of what you're doing. I mean, taking the cap on and off when you're going to refill it, if you're not careful and you hit the coil, it's going to knock things out of whack. But if you're careful with it and you just pay a little attention, I mean, I got some stuff here. I mean, I got a LavaGen sitting on the side here that it's got to be going on 4 or 5 months. I haven't even cleaned it, and I'm still using it. So it's just one of those things that you just got to get used to.
Well, what might make it easier, too, for people, Dino, and I don't know if a vendor sells this, but to make it easier, some sort of vendor somewhere should sell, in a sense, a toolkit for rebuildables that comes with a little mini torch and all the little tools you would need to use everything. That's another problem, too. You got to find the tools to use, where to get them. If a vendor sold a kit that had everything together, a rebuildable toolkit, I mean, that would make it a lot easier. I would maybe think, okay, maybe I'll buy this toolkit. Now I have all the stuff I need to do this. Maybe I'll give it a shot again. Who knows?
I'll tell you what. One of the tables that I saw in Florida, they were selling accessories. It might have been Zen or something. Like, you had a little torch you could buy there for, you know, maybe it was $30 or something like that. But,
right. You
know, the reality of it is a lot of the people who are doing this right now, they're tinkerers. Like, there's a guy here, oh boy, it's like Tinker's my middle name. I got all that stuff in the garage, but I don't want to keep it in my living room. I don't want to keep it in my desk. You know, like he's probably got, you know, Dino's got like a little, he's got a big torch over here, a little one over there. Yeah. You know, he's set up for it, and he's probably gotten to that point. Like, I'm sure, I trashed my dining room a half a dozen times. My wife will tell you, but. Yeah, see, he's got, you know, a surgical kit.
I mean, it's got all these little, like, hemostats and all this, I mean, all little tools that I use. I mean, you're right. I got a lot of stuff that I accumulated. I'm sure that somebody could put together some type of a kit that would cover everything.
That's actually a really good idea.
All those surgical tools, I mean, I'm sure there's only certain ones out of there you use. And if someone had a kit with all this stuff, it would be great. I mean, it would be so much simpler. And people, I think, would be more apt to want to give it a try. They say, okay, I buy the rebuildable, I buy the kit. You know, there's plenty of videos out there to teach people how to do it. And, it would just be a lot easier as well. That's the other problem, is tools. I do what Drew does. I got to go out to my garage, and I'm trying to find this and that and the other and all these tools that are going to work. And it's...
Listen, I probably got a half a dozen lighters in my house that are mini torches. You know, for years I collected lighters, like all them Calibras and all the other ones. But I know Dino, too. I just sent him, like, three things. Like, I know I'm going to have to bite the bullet and get used to it. But I think what I'm going to do is just set up, like, a little sub-bench in my garage or something, or... Yeah, maybe I'll look into making up one of them little kits. That sounds like Craftsman. I know, like, I probably got a half a dozen of them. I got little Craftsman kits that got like a little pair of needle nose, little pair of cutters, little, you know, ratchet screwdriver. You know, you figure out how to fit a torch in there and zip it all back up, and you know, you don't have to have a workbench in your dining room or your living room. A lot of people don't have, you know, spots to,
you know,
dedicate like
the best
like
way to determine what kind of, if you wanted to make a toolkit to sell as a as something to the public that would cover all the bases, start a thread in one of the sub forums, and you know, what would you like to see in this kit? You'll probably get a compilation of things that you'll be able to fit in a little package like this that you could sell for $20-$30 to and that it would have everything that you need to do this, you know. But again,
you know, the other thing is this,
you don't want to do it.
You know, I'll tell you what, once I get proficient at making them, like I'm waiting on some stuff, I got to order some different stuff, and I'm waiting on a couple different addies. But once I get proficient at making them, I'm probably going to make some up and torch them and sell them pre-made. You know, something like that, what you just did, if you were set up and you cut 50 of them and did 50 little things and torched 50 things, you could do that in, you know, a fraction of the time that it would take somebody to do 50 of them. But if you have it made up with the right wire, the right length of the wire, the right mesh, the right cable, everything, the right extent of leads, you could, you know, listen, you could what's that cost? What's that cost you, under a dollar? That material that you just used, you know, to finish that wick.
Yeah.
Now, if you're buying it in bulk, it's probably even cheaper.
Yeah. Well, you know what? Zen, actually, when you buy his mod, he sends his mod out, and it's completely set up where you can start. But I got to tell you, every device is different. So.
Right.
To try to make up like pre-made wicks and coils to sell, you know, it's not really applicable, because you have, like, this device has a two and a half millimeter wick hole. This device has a 3.2 millimeter wick hole. So you got to really make your setup for that mod in order for it to work properly. But, you know, again, it's not for everybody. I mean, that's why there's people selling cargo tanks and people selling rebuildables, you know?
The other thing I'm looking for, I've been looking for, everybody knows that China's coming out with a ton of them. Now, you ask Dino, he's like, you know, they all suck, they fall apart, you know, I didn't want them, I've seen them, I've tried them, but some of them are coming out, like I sent a couple to Dino, some of them are coming out with some pretty good quality. He hasn't got them yet. But, like, you know, I got one, I think it's the AGAF or something like that. This thing's solid, man. It's almost too heavy.
Yeah,
so,
you know, I agree with you there. They got some stuff that they're starting to get a little better at it. But they're still missing a lot of the details that make a Genesis Addy work better than another. And,
right.
And the details are, you know, if they could figure out how to, you know, do it the right way, they got the facilities to do it, there's no question about it,
right?
But they got to start paying attention to the details, and part of the problem is that they'll, like, for instance, the ground screw on a Genesis Addy needs to be right next to the wick hole. You look at some of these Chinese rebuildables, their ground screw is a mile away from the wick hole, and all that does is create,
why does that have to be right next to it, Dino?
Because where the wire catches the ground, from that point to the point it makes contact with the wick, if it's too far away, it creates a hot leg. Like, juice will never hit it. So it just burns, and it just turns red. So now, pretty much you're vaping, a portion of that coil is glowing, and you don't want that. So, I mean, if you look at this, I don't know if you could switch on this camera, on my desk camera real quick. But if you look at it, you'll see that the ground screw is very, very close to the wick hole. And if you look at, I don't know, I don't even think I have one here. If you look at like an RSST, which you have, Kevin, you'll notice that the ground screw is a lot further away from the wick hole, which makes it harder to set up, and it also gets you, you know, it gives you that burnt taste.
Right.
You know? So the quality of the device, look, I'm a firm believer in you get what you pay for. You know, you buy a $30 rebuildable, you're going to have to deal with the pains in setting up until someone teaches them how to do it correctly. And they're not far off. I got news for you. I mean, the AGA and the AGI, all of them, they're not bad devices. They just need to pay attention to the details.
Right. Well, and that's one of the things. I can do that. You know, I can make them change it, you know, and get it right. But, you know, one of the things, honestly, and I talked to you about it. I talked to Cisco about this probably 150 times. Like, I've been steering away from it because it just seems like, you know, and there's probably a lot of suppliers that this is something that, like, somebody needs to concentrate on, get the right stuff, not just, you know, go on and find the first one that works and get it, but use them. There's a lot of little things, like, just like that you just said just there about the hole. I would never notice that in a million years. Yeah. You know, the right size wire, the right size wick, the right size stuff, get it all together. And put it now. This is the other thing. Like, you look in the chat here, there's a half a dozen people in there that say they do it like this, they do it like that. They have, you know, they like to do it this other way and do it that way. But I'll tell you what, whatever it is, what, you know, the one that I have set up is definitely the one for me. So, right. You know, that would obviously be the one that I would go with. But you might have six other people who are doing six other things. You know?
The reason why I went to rebuildables was because I was hearing that vaping was going to be banned. And So I figured that I had to learn how to do this because now that I have all these devices, all the things that I need to make it work, I can buy in a hardware store. So I don't have to worry about today, tomorrow, they put a ban on e-cigs. I still have my devices. Granted, I still need to buy e-juice. All right? So, you know, I'm not doing any of that on my own. But that's the reason why I started with rebuildables, because I was afraid that it was going to get banned. And what's going to happen if I can't buy another cartomizer? I'm screwed. I'm going to go back to smoking again. So that's what prompted me to start doing this.
Yeah.
You know, today, tomorrow, they ban e-cigs. You guys are going to be looking for your cartomizers. You're going to be calling me to set up your gens.
I'm going to be calling you to set up the gens anyway. You don't have to ban shit. Listen, I'm definitely going to get you to set up a few. We're going to have a session, pal. We're going to have a live session with some training on these things for sure. Because,
you know what it is?
Yeah, listen, I think I got it. You know?
With Kevin, I had a few times that I wanted to sit down and do it with him. But then food got in the way, and it was that, and the friggin' rebuildables portion of the meeting went out the window because we were eating. So,
well, that's where you made a mistake. You just started building them for me and not showing me how, and then I just got into that habit, and you know. But then I have to, like, it's a whole thing. I have to drive to New York or mail them. I don't know. It seems like all just a pain to me, especially when I'm so satisfied by an atomizer.
And, well, I would love for you to just drop all those in the mail to me again. Let me rebuild them again for you and try it one more
time.
Listen,
here's an idea. This is what we should do.
The only one I would do it again with, you know, and I'll try it if you want, is the LavaGen, because I think the LavaGen worked way better than the RSST. It just did. You know, the RSST was okay, but I didn't get what I got off that LavaGen the first time I used it. That was fantastic. That's the best that's the best rebuildable vape I've gotten is from that LavaGen.
This is what we got to do. We got to pick a day. We got to get all the stuff. We'll get, like, how many other people come? We'll get, like, FEU's guys, a couple other guys. Everybody come here. I'll set this table up with all the stuff. We'll make up. We'll do, like, a seminar. We'll film the whole thing. Mm-hmm. And then we can sell it to the people who need it. Now, we'll film the whole thing. Maybe we'll do, like, some highlights on here, right? We'll get all the stuff, and then we'll set up kits, and then we'll run like a test and see who, you know. We know Dino's going to be doing them forever because he's got it down. My wife will make dinner, and we'll eat, but we'll keep the food and the, yeah, the stuff separate, because you know, you start showing Dino food, he loses his thing. He loses his concentration. If he sees my wife's pasta and meatballs, dude, he'll just fall apart. Oh, you won't get another word of vaping out of him. But we'll get the good bread, we'll get the olive oil and all the stuff. And
yeah, I mean, look, it's to the point now that I have. It's almost like the way you fill up a cargo tank is the way I'm doing my rebuildables. It's gotten that easy for me. So if it's any consolation to the people that are not familiar with it, it does get easier, but you got to put the time in. That's the only thing I can say.
Yeah.
And that's the hard part for me is finding time to do all that. I mean, I could go to Drew's, but I'd have to drive through New Jersey. I don't know.
Hey, listen, bro, by the time you get to New York, you're only 30, 40 minutes away from here. I think you could probably actually go a different way.
It's not the time. Actually, it'd probably take almost the same amount of time for me to drive there as it would New York City, because it's New York City traffic. It's just actually having to drive through New Jersey.
Yeah, I don't like driving in Jersey either, to be honest with you.
Where I'm at, it's nice.
I'm willing to give the Lavagen a try. I love the Lavagen. When I got that at Vape Ash, I'm telling you, I used it all weekend. It was great. It was fantastic. It's just having to build it. It just seems like such a pain when there's so much great stuff coming out now. I mean,
I don't agree with you. I don't think there's that such great stuff coming out. I mean, I see all these pro tanks and they just don't give me the satisfaction that these do. You know, not to mention the dry hits and the, you know, enough for now. I hear a lot of that you guys got to do a lot of tinkering that with that stuff too. You know, I hear people complaining they got to pull a wick out or they got to rebuild it. I mean, there's a bit of tinkering involved with that as well. You know, but I just haven't seen anything. Look, I'm going to tell you right now, if they came out with something that would give me the satisfaction that I get from these rebuildables, I would be all over it. But I just haven't seen it yet. And I'm sure that as the technology gets better, it's, you know, things will get easier.
I don't think they're going to come out with anything that's touching a rebuildable right now. Maybe in the future, who knows. But no, you're not going to find something that's giving you as good a vape as a rebuildable is. But you can find, but the thing that they're coming out with now, you know, an example, you know, the EVOD and stuff like that. There's something I just got today. I can't wait to get it. It was a throwback. I remember three and a half years ago, I used to use the RN4062. The RN4062 was like a cigar. In fact, I know you remember that, Drew, the RN4062?
Yep.
Pure Spork used to sell it as, they called it the Bada Bing. And I love that. Yep, they called it the Bada Bing. And I love that thing because the carts were huge on it.
It was an 801 atomizer down inside of it. As soon as it went bad, you had to change the whole unit.
Yeah, I mean, it was great. It vaped great. It had good bat. It came with these two little tiny batteries, and it was probably dangerous stacking these batteries, but it just was good battery life. And for that time period, it was like the greatest thing out there, and I love that thing. I mean, I used it, I can't tell you for how long, until obviously better stuff came out. I believe what got me off it was the Tornado, because that was like the first Ego type of battery. Totally, we could have the Tornado. And then it just went from there. But
what is this thing you got coming? Is it a secret or?
No, I bought a Zeus from Vapor for Life. I was watching reviews on it today. I watched a Grim Green review, the Pibusarda review, and Grim Green said it's just fantastic. You know what's great is it kind of looks like the old RN4062, but the battery's a 5-volt battery.
I wish you would have called me.
Wish I have called you.
I got them here, dude. Listen, I developed them with Steve from Vapor for Life in China. We spent 5 days at the table.
I'll tell you, I like the finish on it. It looks like a cigar.
Dude, it's a great. Hold on a second, I'll get it.
Yeah, like the smiley miser, as they call it, and Grim and people started both said there's a nice clean taste to it. It's actually a lot better than Bocardos, and I was fine with Bocardos. Just looks so appealing to me, and they're like, and Grim Green was like, this thing is so easy. You just fill it and go. It holds three and a half mils in this cart. It's got like a rubber tip on the end where you can like hold it in your mouth like a cigar. I mean, it. I was all about it. I saw those videos, and that was it. I just went and ordered it before the show. I had to have it. I mean, it just looks so simple and easy to use, and you know, and it comes. What's cool is it comes with an. It's an automatic and manual battery. I bought the one that's both, so I can have it be manual if I want, or I just click it and shut it off, and it's automatic, which is great. I mean, it's a really cool device, and it's. The fact that it's so simple and everybody's saying how good it is, I just had to get one. It's like I'm not leaning towards rebuildables. I'm not like trying to find things that are easier. They're going to give me right. a great, yeah, it looks like that. What is that, Drew? Is that, yep.
This is the Vapor Zeus.
Yep, that's
Dude, I've been using these for a year. I can't believe you haven't seen them. I have black ones. I have the original prototypes. This is the production. This is the final one.
Yeah, well, I'm just saying, they just put it up for sale not too long ago. I mean, it's...
No, I'm telling you, listen, 2 years... You know, you remember when I went to China with him? It was right after the first Chicago.
Yes.
Hold on a second, I'll get the other ones. I'll show you all. I got all the prototypes.
You know, Kevin, I think what it boils down to is what you're ultimately going to be satisfied with. You know, if it's something that you're going to be... You know, it's going to give you that satisfaction. Then fine, it's going to work.
I don't think it exists though, Dino, because I want ease of use, like the Zeus, how it looks so easy to use and how small it is. I love everything about it. I don't have it yet, but what I've seen looks great. Right. But
this is I can't hear what you guys are saying, so pay attention because I'm away. I don't have the thing on. Where am I at? This is the first one. We were going to make this with Delrin, because the rubber one, this is the next one. This is metal underneath. And there was a few different sizes. This is the first button. I don't know if you can see that. You click it 5 times.
Yep.
It's automatic. Then click it 5 yep. more times.
Goes to manual. Yep.
It's manual. This is the next size with the next button. Same thing. You click it 5 times, and it's auto or whatever. But we were gonna make it with Delrin. You can see it got chewed up. All right, we'll go back to over here because they can't hear me that good, I guess. Can you hear me now? All right, so yeah, so we went with like 4 or 5. I'll tell you what, this thing is built as far as the cartomizer goes. We tried every combination of airflow, every combination of the height of the wick, the filler, the packing, the air holes in the bottom. This is as close as you're going to get to a perfect cartomizer as there is. This is my take on the downsides of it. It looks like a cigar and it feels like a cigar. Right? This rubber tip's great. You can actually chew on it and hold it in your mouth.
Yep.
Can't hear that. I think I just broke my tooth on it. But the hit on it, it's like, it's harsh. You know, it's, you remember the old cartomizers, how like the old 808s, how they were like harsh? Even now, a lot of the 808s now, if you put a strong liquid in them, they're kind of harsh. So that's what this is. This is great, dude. I take it with me all the time. I got brand new cartomizers. I was just talking to Steve last week. He sent me like 6 or 7 of the latest cartomizers. This is just auto. This one's just auto. And this one is auto or
manual.
Right. But dual mode.
It's not
going to
be harsh for me because, and I did read a little bit about that, but it's not going to be harsh for me because I use 12 milligram juice. So it works out. It's not like I use 24.
It's not that. It's the air. It's the airflow. Like, it doesn't matter what juice you put in. And that's just for me. You might love it. You might love it. If you like harsher cartomizers or whatever, it's an 808 connection. So people have used 808s. Understand that 808s could be a little bit more harsh because of the airflow. But I have 510 batteries coming in. Same thing, same design. The button's going to be a little different. You know, obviously it's going to be a 510 connection. I have revolver batteries now that are automatic. 510 revolver batteries that work with CE4s. Here's one in there. I mean, they work great. It's CE4. I happen to like the way the newer CE4s are working. They have them in dual coil now. And don't get me wrong, the vapors, you know, the other thing about this, dude, you could throw a regular 808 cardo on here. It works good. It's 5 volts all the time.
Right.
So my idea was to get something with a twist on it. So for people that don't want 5 volts that are using a different cartomizer or whatever, they can turn it up and turn it down. So I have, could you, hold on a second. I have one of them here.
Look at this, Dino, you got them started.
You're running the show, man. I'm the host. I'll tell you,
oh my God, your voice sounds like Darth Vader, bro.
Mine?
Yeah. Here's a fully auto. This isn't dual. This is an auto battery, and this is the prototype. I don't know if you can see that. Instead of having a CE4, it's just got a 510 connection on it, and it's a twist. It's this is 900 mAh, so it's not quite as big, you know, as the Zeus. Or whatever, and you can put any kind of cartomizer on there, turn it up, turn it down, and 510 connection. You know what I mean? So, listen, I'll tell you what, I think Vapor for Life is going to, I think Steve's coming out with a 510 also. But, dude, he went to great, he's been working on a thing for 2 years to come out with it. Like the finish and everything, don't get me wrong, it's great, but it ain't a rebuildable. Well, you'll probably like that, Kevin. I think that thing they say it holds about 3 mils of liquid.
Yeah, it's 3.5 mils. 3.5 mils of liquid, and you know that's what I was telling Dino. I mean, he says you got to get your idea thing. Well, my idea thing is a Zeus that vapes like a rebuildable, and that just doesn't exist.
Well, let me ask you a question. Is my sound better now?
Yeah, it's much better. You sound so sexy.
Are you willing to accept sacrifice? Performance for ease of use?
Yes, and well, sometimes I do want to sacrifice performance for ease of use. And sometimes I would want to do the work to have the performance. I mean, it just depends, to be honest. I don't know.
I have to agree with them. This is a great device for me to have. Don't get me wrong, bro. There's times where I got to run, I got to jump in my car, I got one of these filled up, man, it's in my pocket, it's done deal. I know I'm going to be able to get a satisfying hit. Now, I can't sit on my couch and vape that thing the way I like to vape some. Like if I was vaping that the whole time now, I'd be like, my throat's hurting, it's too harsh or whatever. But if I got to run out and I want to take a few hits here and there, that thing's perfect. And but listen, that's everybody's not running around yet with rebuildables all the time. You know, like I know, like right now, he's using a 357. I know he's got a probably a dozen devices there he could be using with rebuildables on it, and it's, you know, it's just one of those things. You know, variety is the spice of life. The other thing is this. The only thing I don't like about the Zeus is it's not that, you know, it's good with what it's made to do. With that cartomizer, you know, that ohm cartomizer, 5 volts, filled up, it's perfect. I'd rather have something like this that I can turn it up and down. I can take this off. I could put a rebuildable on here if I wanted to. Now, it's not going to rock a sub-ohm cartomizer long, but if I want to build, you know, that little rebuildable that he was messing with earlier, that little tiny dripper one or the small tank one, that'd go right on this battery. Mm-hmm. You know, I could build it with a 1.2, 1.5 ohm coil on there and throw it on there and I can do whatever. Or I can put it automatic, I can flip it over to automatic and I can use whatever I want, but or use it manually. So that's really the only thing I would say. But there's a ton of people, you know, just like we were saying, turn the key and drive. They don't care. They don't need to run, you know, 4 different CE4s, a cardo tank, or a rebuildable, or anything else. They get that. They might never mess with anything else again. You know, well, and that's what I thought when I got them. But the reality of it is. I don't use them that often. I have it there on my desk filled up, but all right, listen, we're over time. Kevin. Hey,
quick, there's a lot of people that all they know through is that stuff. I was on a site today, I forgot what, some Facebook for some big vendor, and there was a woman that I typed in there, she said, I wish there were shows about vaping. She has no clue. I mean, she's one of those, the typical stick battery users. She has no idea of all this stuff, of anything. There's a lot of people like that. And they're used to just ease of use, twisting a cartomizer on and going and throwing it away and putting on a new one. They don't want it.
Well, and Kev, not to, you know, toot my own horn, but that's what this is for. And I was talking to Dino earlier about it. Like, I know I could fill this chat room right up. All I got to do is say I'm giving away an Opus D or do whatever. But the main focus of these shows is not to have all the spam, you know, like, I don't think I've mentioned my company name yet tonight, and or my products, and I try not to. I don't want to make it a spam advertisement. I want to make good information, get good people on here, objectively talk about the different devices, as many as I can. I want this to get viewed over a year, not, you know, tonight. Like, I know I could, like I said, I could fill the room up. I could spam it all over the place. I could put my name all over the place. I could get 10 vendors to come in here and give away stuff and fill this chat room right up. But the bottom line is I want to get good information, try to get good information, and put it up and, you know, talk. Listen, Ben, zoom in on Dino's head, will you, hon? Hey, you put him full screen.
It's going to be my headband next week. In 2 weeks. Can you get it?
What's that say? Oh, inhaler.com. All right, listen, Kevin.
Yes.
Help us out. You know what? I'm going to give away a Vapor Zeus fully automatic unit with 2 new atomizers right now to run a contest.
And I just paid for one? Okay, geez. I guess we'll
listen,
have
you started.
We'll think of a question.
I got a question.
Good. Dino's got a question.
What if they were paying attention to the show, I showed a pair of cutters made by a certain company. I mentioned the name. Anybody remember the name?
Oh, I know this one. Almost.
First one to type in the name wins. Got to be quick. In the chat.
Oh, there you go. Paw Night 290.
Coconut cream pie. Love Boy said coconut cream pie.
Paw 292 got it.
Is it Nimex? Is that
no,
the brand?
It's close enough. Nipex.
That part, I'll tell you what, man. She wins every week. I think we That's got good. Her. We just auto send to her. Let me ask you this, Par. How did you like the pipe? Did you use it? Be honest.
Oh, she got one of those Cardo pipes?
Yeah.
She gave it to her husband.
How's he like it? Oh, he likes it. Cool. All right, so you know the drill, Par. My wife's typing it in now. Listen, I want to thank everybody for coming in. Dino, Kevin, thank you very much. Next time, before you go buy one of them crazy devices, call me up, Kevin. I got them right here. I'll send you a couple Cardos anyway. I think I got like a half a dozen of the Cardos.
I bought a bunch of those, too.
How much are they, retail?
They were five for 37, I think. $37 for five of them.
So what's that? That's
like $7 a piece.
That ain't bad. I'll tell you what, that was one of the downsides that we were talking about when we were getting them. I know for a fact, like, he's paying close to $5.
Yep.
For that. I probably shouldn't say that, but you know, normally the markup on a cartomizer or something like that, it's a lot higher than that, honestly. You look at one of those Cardos, it's a stainless steel tip. The rubber tips alone, even in China, they're expensive to have them made. So, you know, I think at one point he was talking about, you know, selling them for $9, $10. I think that's what they are now, right, if you just buy one?
One is like $8. And then he sells ones that are actually bigger. He also sells ones that hold 6 mils, which is crazy. I just got the small ones.
Yeah, I think that's the one I'm talking about. That's this one here.
Yeah.
Yeah, and this is actually the prototype of it. This isn't how it looks. You know, if you bought it, it would have either a black tip.
It's not that it's too big. Way too big. 3.5 mils is fine. I mean, 3.5 mils is a lot.
Yeah, and I'll tell you this, if you hit it too fast, it won't even wick the 3.5 mils. You know, you got to give it time for the liquid to wick. If you take like four, and any cartomizer, it doesn't matter what, you can't like hit it, you can't chain vape it.
Right.
It'll get, you know, a burnt taste. But at any rate, all right, thanks very much, everybody, for stopping in. We'll see you in 2 weeks. Next time we're actually going to build something. We're going to blow clouds of vapor over your head, and we'll see you then. Again, thank you very much. Go.